I'm just gonna go ahead and warn you. This video approaches a controversial topic. Some of you will disagree with me. Yay, some of you may be downright angry at the choices that I put on my 20 greatest rock drummers that you're wrong for not knowing. Rock and roll is still relatively a new art form, but who are the greatest players and what makes them the greatest players? Is it their chops? Is it their groove? Is it how many songs they played on? Is it how chart-topping the band was? What do you use to decide the criteria for who the greatest players are in a genre? Well, if you caught my last one, 20 jazz drummers, you're wrong for not knowing, then you know the criteria that I go by. And oh, let me tell you, some of you were angry with the ones that I left off. So let me explain very quickly. I view the greatest as not only those that are most well known, but those that also have had the biggest contribution, not just to the musical art form, but to the community as a whole. So we don't just weigh them on like, are they good players? Yeah, sure, are they good players, but what did they do for the community and what did they do for the art form as well? One more thing you should also know. I list these more chronologically than I do like the number one best. So we're gonna go through the history of rock and roll by looking at the most notable players in that genre. Two quick resources you can use to dive deeper into this. A Modern Drummer put out an excellent series on this. It was back, I believe the first one was released in 1982 by Scott Fish, and it's 5 or 6 part series on just the history of rock and roll, the greatest players, all of those. As well, you can pick up this book. It's The Roots of Rock Drumming. No, I don't get a thing for selling this book. It's just a good book. You should know the history of your instrument. It's edited by Daniel Glass. He's a well-known drumming historian, as well as Steve Smith. Some of you will agree, some of you will disagree, some of you will just be angry. Put it in the comments below. I want to hear from all of you. Let's get down to this. The 20 rock drummers you're wrong for not knowing. The first one on the list, a lot of you, may I say 99% of you, have never heard of. His name is Fred Below. Now, obviously, he comes out of the jazz idiom, the jazz genre, because that's what was going on before rock and roll. You have to remember, we're at the beginning of this, all right? He played with Little Walter early on in his drumming career, and he was a graduate of the Roy C. Knapp School of Drumming. And some of you may be like, what's the Roy C. Knapp School of Drumming? I'm glad you asked. This guy put through the best of the best. His roster includes, let me just read it off to you, past students Davey Tuff, Gene Krupa, Buddy Rich, Baby Dodds, Big Sid Catlett, Louie Belson, Fred Below, Buddy Harmon, Shelly Mann, Ed Shaughnessy, Hal Blaine, Mel Torme, and so many others. Like, that's just, so to say the least, Roy knew what he was doing when it came to teaching drummers, all right? So he had a tough time, Fred had a tough time figuring out rock and roll at the beginning. You have to remember, it's vastly different than jazz. He had a tough time figuring out the genre of the blues and rock and roll. He was responsible for creating much of the rhythmic structure of Chicago blues, especially the backbeat. He's credited as being the first drummer to play that 2 and 4 backbeat, which is notorious. Like, that is a staple in rock and roll. He began developing some of the staples that we're accustomed to hearing in rock and roll, like the heavy reverb on the drums. Check out the song from 1952 called She's All Right. As well, check out the track I'm Ready from, it's around 1954 is when that one came out. And it's the first use of the ride cymbal as well as the snare backbeat on 2 and 4. Now look, this Muddy Waters lineup of musicians with Fred Below on drums, Little Walter, and then the Myers Brothers is thought by many people to be the prototype band that paved the way for the rock sound. You've got the heavy drums, you've got the backbeats, the amplifiers, like all of the elements are there. We just had to bring them together. Some notable tracks to check out would be from around 1960, you've got Wang Dang Doodle by Howlin' Wolf. And that album, it's got a great compilation I wrote down here of Howlin' Wolf tracks is Blues from Hell. So that's a great compilation. It has this song on it. And then I'm Your Hoochie Coochie Man by Muddy Waters from 1954. Crazy great drum sound on that one. The second drummer on our list is Dick Richards. In 1955, Richards was a member of the band that achieved a first. It was the first band to achieve rock star status, right? The Comets, that was the name of the band, and their song was Rock Around the Clock. This song skyrocketed them to success. It helped them establish rock as a worldwide phenomenon. It was also the first rock song to hit number one. It was the first record to be used in a movie, and it is still considered and regarded to this day as one of the all-time great rock anthems. It brought together the sound, it brought together the energy and the magic that would become rock and roll. Richards grew up in a suburb of Philly, listening to the drummers of the swing era. Louis Belson was a huge influence on him. And then the Comets were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame around 2012. Check Out is playing on the album Rock Around the Clock by the Comets. It's got that song, it's got Rock a Beat and Boogie, and also Shake, Rattle and Roll. The third candidate on our list is none other than Mr. Earl Palmer. This guy, one of my faves, a member of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He was raised in the Treme District in New Orleans. I got the opportunity to live in New Orleans and gig in New Orleans for about 3 years from the age of 19 to 22. So huge love for that city and the players that came out of there. Earl is often considered the architect of rock and roll drumming. He played on some of the most important and influential early rock and roll recordings that are out there. On top of that, you have to remember, this was not a musical style. So like the guys are sitting there playing, they're like, I don't know what to play. They don't go play rock groove number three. There was no rock groove number three. So Earl was credited with coming up with many of the popular drum grooves that that populate rock and roll today, as well as a lot of the popular drum fills that populate rock and roll. He is credited as being the first drummer that actually played a straight eighth note groove. Up until that time, you gotta remember, we got jazz, we got the blues, all shuffling and swinging. To hear some of that, you can listen to Little Richard's early stuff. You can hear the push and pull between some of the players trying to swing and some trying to play straight. It's a very unique time in music history, and it's a very unique feel to try to cop. Here's a cool little fact. So Palmer said that Little Richard actually used to go between swung and a straight feel. He said that Little Richard wasn't the best piano player out there, but the charisma, the star, you know, it was all there. The energy was all there. Another component of rock and roll later on is that star factor. And so he said that in his playing, to try to cover for that, he would try to play between straight and swung in kind of in the cracks and try to not make it apparent to the listener. So to do that, Palmer would open up the hi-hats just a little bit so that it would kind of mask some of that feeling of going from straight to swung. It was really kind of a cool little trick that he did to level things out, and a cool little trick that you can do whenever you are playing that style or whatnot. Look for that when you're listening to those recordings. His list of recording credits looks like a who's who of that time, but to me, his most important contributions came from his playing with Fats Domino and Little Richard. Check out the album, Here's Little Richard. I believe Palmer is on every one of those cuts except for track 2 and track 12, if my memory serves me correct. Our next player, number 4, hails from around the same area as Earl Palmer, Shreveport, Louisiana. He was the house drummer for the radio and later the TV show Louisiana Hayride, and that's none other than the impeccable Mr. DJ Fontana. Dominic Joseph Fontana is best known for his work with Elvis Presley. He played with him for over 14 years. He was on over 460 RCA cuts with Elvis. Like Earl Palmer, DJ really helped write the blueprint, the playbook for what rock and roll drumming would sound like and what rock in general would sound like with his playing on cuts like Heartbreak Hotel, Hound Dog, Blue Suede Shoes, Love Me Tender, and a ton more. He was a huge influence on drummers like Ringo Starr and Charlie Watts of the Rolling Stones. In the 1970s, DJ became a staple in the Nashville session scene, playing with the likes of Johnny Cash, Ringo Starr, Paul McCartney, Dolly Parton, and a ton more. Check out the self-titled album from Elvis Presley from around 1956 for some of DJ's playing. Now, I wrote it down here. The tracks that Fontana is not playing on that album are I Love You Because, Just Because, Trying to Get to You, I'll Never Let You Go, Little Darlin', and Blue Moon. This fifth one, some of you may not know. Some of you may, again, get downright angry that he's included on this because you don't know him and I didn't include some big rock star that you think should be on here. But let me just tell you why he's on here. He is widely hailed as one of the most recorded drummers of all time. over 35,000 sessions, 6,000 singles, is featured on 150 US top 10 hits, and has 40 number one tracks to his credit. If you want to talk about the greatest, not just in rock, but of all time, this guy's right up there with the top of the tops, the best of the best, the cream of the crop. It's Mr. Hal Blaine. He moved to California around 1943 and became a member of one of the notorious recording session groups of that time. It's called the Wrecking Crew, and it's a group of studio musicians. You had several of these across the United States. I'll get into them more here just a little bit later. And he became a huge component of what would they call Phil Spector. He is the guy that hired these musicians, his wall of sound and what he was hired for. Be sure to check out, there's a great documentary on the Wrecking Crew. I believe it used to be on Netflix, but now I'm not sure, but just type that in the Googles and figure out where you can watch it. It's fantastic. One track of note from that time is the Ronettes' Be My Baby. This groove, this beat would go on to be imitated quite a bit. Again, these guys are writing the playbook for what rock and roll sounds like, and so this is like the first guys are hearing this and they're like, oh, what is that beat? Okay, it's that time period for this musical genre. He was responsible for inspiring an entire generation of up-and-coming rock drummers that are about to just explode on the scene. The Beach Boys, the Mamas and the Papas, Elvis, the Byrds, Sonny and Cher, and tons more. All of those Hal played with and recorded with. All right, albums to listen to with somebody like Hal Blaine, just like pick any of them. They're fantastic. As well, he's a studio musician, so he wasn't always the only drummer on an album. But for me, he wasn't the only drummer on this album, but it's really hard for me to skip the Beach Boys' Pet Sounds. I've got it sitting on vinyl right there. You should get it, listen to it over and over and over. It's just such a revolutionary album. As well, some others would be Bridge Over Troubled Water by Simon and Garfunkel, and If You Can Believe Your Eyes and Ears by the Mamas and the Papas. All of those are great albums to check out his drumming on. Now, I promise you, we're gonna get to some players that you're like, oh, I know that guy, I love that guy, but we've got to set the stage for this. I told you this list might make some of you angry, but hopefully it educates some of you as well. The sixth one is Mr. Brian Bennett. We have to mention Brian. We've got to have a representative of the British rock and roll scene that's happening at the same time as this rock and roll revolution is coming about in the United States. We're over in the States, we're very familiar with what they call the British Invasion. It's where these bands that made it huge here in the States came over. But at the same time, they had a killer vibrant scene going on there as well. So Brian started playing professionally around 1956 at the age of 16 with a skiffle group there in Ramsgate. Now, look, we'll talk a little bit more about skiffle music in a little bit because a couple of drummers in the rock scene came out of that genre, that style of music. Shortly after 1956, he moved back to London and began a stint as the house drummer for the Two Eyes Coffee Bar and was a regular performer on Jack Good's TV show, Oh Boy. He moved on to a successful stint with Marty Wilde's Wildcats and then in 1961 joined his rocket to stardom, The Shadows. The Shadows were Britain's first like superstar rock act. You remember me talking about the Comets being the first superstar rock act? Well, that was The Shadows for Britain. And their lineup would become the prototype lineup for rock and roll bands like from then on. Two guitars, the bass, and the drums. I don't know, the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, anyone? What made the Shadows lethal on two fronts, just drop dead killers, was they could back as a band the teen idol at the time, Cliff Richards, but then they could turn around and command a venue of the same size and fill it up with their own fans. Their concerts were nuts, riotous, they sold out, screaming fans, exact same thing that was happening over in the States. It was just very similar scene. So that's why we have to represent, like we have these different pockets of rock and roll just skyrocketing. Bennett went on to do a ton of session work with the likes of Olivia Newton-John and Al Stewart, as well as a great second career. He's not the only one that does this, by the way. We have a few guys on this that go on to a second career as an award-winning film and TV composer. Check out The Shadows album, Dance with the Shadows, for a great kind of look at Brian's drumming. Now's the time some of you have been waiting for. You've been sitting there rubbing your hands like, when's he gonna mention him? When's he gonna mention him? It's right now, number seven, Ginger Baker. An emotionally volatile person, an explosive player, an eccentric figure, Ginger was all of these and more. His work in the 1960s and the 1970s have earned him the title of rock's first superstar drummer. Baker was a jazz drummer at heart, and this is the theme you'll see his entire life, him fighting this thing of being in the rock scene, but being a jazz purist at heart. He was influenced by the guys like Baby Dodds. If you watch my video on the top 20 jazz drummers, you'll see Baby Dodds is one of the first on there. Max Roach was on there, Art Blakey, all three of those guys. So here you have a guy in the greatest rock drummers, right? He's influenced by all of those. By adding his touch of jazz, he probably became what would be the first, what we call a crossover, for the first true jazz rock fusion drummer. In 1963, Baker helped form the group, the Graham Bond Organization. Now, it was made up of Baker, Jack Bruce, who was a longtime rhythm section partner of his, and Graham Bond. Jack Bruce was later in Cream with him as well. Little fact you may not know, jazz great John McLaughlin actually came through this group as well at one time. In 1966, Baker left that group and went on to form Cream with Eric Clapton. The rest is rock and roll history, right? He was very well known for his double bass work and his extensive drum solos. Later in the 70s, Baker moved over to Africa to kind of really dive into his love for African music, African rhythms, and drumming, often recording with a notable artist from over there named Fela Kuti. Even though the mass public has given Baker much less credit than he deserves, musicians in the know consider him to be the greatest rock and roll drummer of all time. Okay, some playing. What albums do we check out? You gotta check out Cream's album, Disraeli Gears. And for an additional cut that you can kind of hear him at his rawest, purest, best, check out the last cut on Cream's debut album, Fresh Cream, called Toad. Oh yeah, it's that time. Number 8, Mr. Ringo Starr. Richard Starkey is his real name. Ringo Starr is his stage name, gained from the amount of rings that he wore on his hands early on in his career. He's the famed drummer for the Beatles, and like the other members of the Beatles, Richard became interested in a type of music called skiffle. And a lot of you are like, wait a second, skiffle music? Where have I heard that before? You heard of number 6, Brian Bennett. I said we were gonna talk about it later. Later is now. We're gonna talk about what skiffle music is. Skiffle music is a musical genre with its roots in jazz, blues, and American folk music, and it was performed on a mixture of manufactured instruments and homemade instruments. It was originated in the United States in the early part of the 20th century and became extremely popular in the UK in the 1950s, which is right at the time we are, the time that Brian Bennett and Ringo Starr and the Beatles were coming up. So in 1957, Ringo had to start his own skiffle group. It's called the Eddie Clayton Skiffle Group. Over the next few years, he bounced around skiffle group to skiffle group, as many of us do, and around 1962, he replaced Pete Best as the drummer in the Beatles lineup, and the rest, as they say, is history. By the way, a lot of the fans were not happy about that move. Not only was he the drummer for the Beatles, he defined a whole genre of music, helped define rock and roll, the drum parts that go there. I was talking to my dad about this years ago on a car ride to New Orleans, and he asked me about, he said, Ringo Starr, what's the big deal about Ringo? I'm like, you gotta understand, Dad, you gotta understand. At that time, what he was playing had not been played before. So when Ringo played it, or when Hal Blaine played it, or when Earl Palmer played it, that was the first time people had heard that. And they're like, what is that crazy sound? It was rock and roll, and Ringo was one of the innovators. He's had a crazy successful solo career, recording with artists like Elton John, Harry Nilsson, Peter Frampton, Steven Tyler, Tom Petty, even Ozzy Osbourne. Okay, obviously, songs to check out, we could just say insert entire Beatles catalog right here, but let me break out a couple of these. To me, his drumming would be Paperback Writer, that's a great song, Rain, Hello Goodbye, and I Want to Hold Your Hand. Those are all great songs to check out, and then albums Abbey Road and Let It Be are two great albums for you to check out by the Beatles.
Thanks, Paige. My Paige.
Number 9, Roger Hawkins. Some of you are like, Stephen, what the flip? Why don't you just tell me drummers that I know? Because then I would just be regurgitating things that you already know. And I wouldn't be giving you the actual history of rock and roll. We gotta talk about Roger Hawkins. You see, at this time, there were pockets of studio musicians all over the United States, I'm sure all over the world, but in the United States, we have a couple that became very, very popular. So we talked about Hal Blaine with the Wrecking Crew over in California, right? Another one that became very, very popular would have been for the Motown era. We're talking about the Funk Brothers. There's a great documentary called Standing in the Shadows of Motown that you gotta check out. You got Uriel Jones and Richard Pistol Allen, all of these fantastic drummers that really defined that genre. What would happen is these musicians, the Wrecking Crew, the Funk Brothers, the one we're about to talk about with Roger Hawkins, they would develop a sound. They would be hired for that sound. And a lot of times these studios worked 24/7 with these musicians because there was such a demand for what they were producing. So the Funk Brothers were out in Detroit. They were in the Motown era. That was between 1959 and 1972. For rock and roll, another big group besides the Wrecking Crew was a group of studio musicians that would help develop what they called that new big beat sound. You remember I talked about them having that wall of sound with the Wrecking Crew. And we also had that kind of big beat sound. This is kind of a supersized groove that we've become accustomed to hearing, but up till that time was not a thing. It was created by the rhythm section and the players in that rhythm section. And another important group was coming out of Muscle Shoals, Alabama. They became known by a couple of terms, the Muscle Shoals rhythm section, but they also became known by one that I actually like better called the Swampers. They mixed elements of soul, R&B, funk, rock, country with the laid-back mood and feel of the Deep South. Think about something like the Kings of Leon on some of their albums that, you know, you get in, you're like, oh, this was recorded in the South. That's the type of thing that they were mixing with these popular R&B, funk, rock, country rhythms. They not only recorded hit albums, they also went on the road as a rhythm section. You saw this happening occasionally. It happened occasionally with the Funk Brothers, where they would take the whole rhythm section on the road. So they went on the road with Traffic. They went on the road with Eric Clapton. Later, they founded and operated their own studio. They were the first rhythm section to ever do that. It was called Muscle Shoals Sound Studio, and then they were also the first rhythm section to have their own recording studio, their own publishing, and their own production companies. I'm going to read you real quick a list of artists that they've helped to attract to the Muscle Shoals, Alabama area to record. It's going to be Aretha Franklin, the Rolling Stones, Bob Dylan, Cat Stevens, Boss Gash, Joe Cocker, Paul Simon, Bob Seger, Rod Stewart, and Willie Nelson, to name a few. Maybe you know one or two of those names. A great album to listen to Roger Hawkins playing on would be Money and Cigarettes by Eric Clapton. Number 10. We're halfway there. We're about to get into some of the big mega superstars. But before we get there, some of you may not know this guy, Jim Keltner. A rock studio legend with a jazz background. Again, a lot of these guys, jazz background. He was born in Tulsa, Oklahoma in 1942. Keltner is a complete chameleon. I love his style. Has been called the leading session drummer in America. Of course, we could also say that Hal Blaine was that. You know, who's gonna grab that title? You know, that's an argument for you guys to have in the comments section. But I'm just saying he has been called that. Now look, I wanna read this to you just so you grasp the importance of Jim Keltner and these studio musicians at the time, even though they weren't on the road with these big rock acts, they were helping to define the sound that some of them were taking out. So in addition to his frequent work with the Beatles, so he worked on all their solo projects, George Harrison, John Lennon, Ringo Starr. And then you've got his list of recording credits here. Let me read this to you. Leon Russell, Gabor Sabazo, Delaney Bramlett, Roy Orbison, Harry Nilsson, Jerry Garcia, Eric Clapton, Steely Dan, Joe Cocker, Van Dyke Parks, The Rolling Stones, Ronnie Wood, Bill Wyman, Mick Jagger, Keith Richards. I'm going to keep going. Bob Dylan, Joni Mitchell, Brian Wilson, Seals and Nash and Young, Phil Keggy, Steve Jones, Crowded House, Fiona Apple. You mean, no, I'll keep going. Elvis Costello, the Bee Gees, Jackson Brown, the Manhattan Transfer, Randy Newman, Ry Cooter, Sam Phillips, Los Lobos, Pink Floyd, Warren Zevon, Rufus Wainwright, Tom Petty, Gillian Welch, the Steve Miller Band, Alice Cooper, Sheryl Crow, and Lucinda Williams. He also specialized in R&B, and he influenced the likes of Danny Serafini of the band Chicago, as well as the late, great Jeff Porcaro. Again, to listen with these session players, man, I don't even know where to start. Again, some of the albums, he's on them, and he's not the only drummer because they hired different guys. But one album that's great where he played all but one song, I believe it was, wrote it down here, John Lennon's Walls and Bridges album. I also personally love his work on Fiona Apple's music. The moment some of you have been waiting for. The man, the myth, the explosive legend, Keith Moon. Never predictable, always unique, eccentric, eclectic, and often self-destructive behavior. Mr. Keith Moon was all of that and more. Moon was born in 1946. Now listen to this, he didn't take up the drums until the early 60s. This is really important for some of you that email me and you're like, Steven, is it too late to start drumming? No, it's not too late. Because by 1964, he had joined The Who, and the rest is rock and roll history. Well known as one of the first rock and roll drummers to use the double bass drum extensively. Now, you'll remember Ginger Baker was another one of those, right? He's our guy that was like angry that he was this rock star, but he was this rock star and he wanted to be a jazz star, but he happened to be this rock star. They were using the double bass. Another one that's not on this list, I hate it, Mr. Ronnie Tutt, Nashville legend here. He also played with Elvis Presley, also for like 15, 12 years, I don't know. Neil Diamond for over 30 years. So many others that he played with. Ronnie, if you haven't checked out Ronnie, he's a beautiful person, beautiful player, beautiful, just beautiful all around. You have to check out his playing. In addition to the double bass drum, he became known for his emphasizing in his playing the use of tom-toms, cymbal crashes, and then lots of drum fills. And you may be like, well, I do that too. Well, he was the first guy that was doing this extensively in a rock setting. Rolling Stone magazine poll voted him as the second greatest drummer of all time. Look, I'm not here to argue that. That's for you guys to argue down in the comments. I'm just here reporting what's happened. As a humorous little side note, and anybody that studied Moon knows this, his self-destructive behavior was incredible and later led to his untimely death. But Moon was fascinated with blowing up toilets with cherry bombs. Not only that, he was fascinated with destroying TV sets for some reason. Why TV sets, I don't know. And he was, hotels across the country, across the world, knew about his destructive capabilities. Unfortunately, Moon died of a drug overdose in 1978. Two fantastic Who albums to check out with him playing on that would be Quadrophenia and then Live at Leeds. Number 12, Mitch Mitchell. He was a child actor early on, and although his drumming career was peppered with tons of other acts, he's best known for his playing with Jimi Hendrix. We just talked about Keith Moon, so in Mitch Mitchell, you had the explosiveness of Keith Moon, but with the finesse of an Elvin Jones. He's also known as he was the person that Hendrix had the longest, important and most sustained creative relationship with, both on the stage and in the studio, of any other musicians that he played with. Mitchell auditioned for the band that was being formed around Jimi Hendrix around 1966, beating out a ton of the other popular young players in the London scene, one of them being Ainsley Dunbar, another guy that came dangerously close to being on this list. Dunbar later worked with the likes of Frank Zappa, Jeff Beck, David Bowie, Sammy Hagar, and a slew of others. For some great playing by Mitch Mitchell, you gotta check out the Jimi Hendrix album, Are You Experienced? The Jimi Hendrix Experience album, Are You Experienced? Number 13, some of you will howl in protest, but to me, no list like this of the greatest rock drummers would be complete without Carmine Appice. Look, I'm not gonna get into how you pronounce his name. All of you know that I'm notorious for pronouncing names incorrectly. Let's take a second and check out some of my favorite grooves by Dave Grohl. But I have actually researched this one a little bit, and if you go look it up, there's several different ways that you can pronounce his name, and he finally just decided on one because it got confusing for people that were not of Italian descent. Here's what's unique about this. Everybody else was jazz, right? They came out of the jazz school. He was classically trained, but influenced by the likes of Buddy Rich and Gene Krupa. So starting in 1967, remember, we're marching up this timeline, Carmine was a member of a band named Vanilla Fudge. Now look, this band, extremely important because they are considered the first heavy rock band. They're also considered to be the American link between psychedelia music and heavy metal. 1967, you have to check out this track, You Keep Me Hanging On, to understand what I'm talking about, that wall of sound, that new big beat. You know, the production was coming of age. You have to understand, before this time, we're so accustomed to it, this sound was not around, not on this level. It had never been heard before. So when you listen to that, just imagine hearing this for the first time and going, whoa! People were blown away by this sound. On top of just being an astonishing player, he's an incredible showman, known worldwide for his live shows, and then he also became a well-known and sought-after studio musician. Listen to this, in 1976, he beat out over 40 other drummers auditioning for Rod Stewart's band. And then we get to see another side of Carmine we haven't seen before, and that's the hit-making machine. He wrote multiple chart toppers with Rod Stewart. I didn't even know this until recently. He was one of the writers on Do You Think I'm Sexy, Best Bass Line Ever, as well as another song, Young Turks. I'm about to read something, but I want to read this just because I don't want to get it wrong. So this is one of the reasons why he is on this list. It has to do with his influence. Remember, I said it's not just good enough to be a superstar. It's not just good enough to have this phenomenal playing. It's what did you do with the craft? What did you do to influence other drummers? So who was listening to you and later came to rock stardom? And also, what did you do for the musical genre? One of the main reasons he's on this list is his influence. So he's said to have influenced Iron Maiden's Nico McBrain, Aerosmith's Joey Kramer, Roger Taylor of Queen, Phil Collins of Genesis, Rush's Neil Peart, Tommy Lee from Motley Crue, Slayer's Dave Lombardo, John Bonham of Led Zeppelin, Ian Pace of Deep Purple, Eric Singer of Kiss. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. He's worked with a wide range of artists from Stanley Clarke to Jeff Beck to Ozzy Osbourne, Ted Nugent, Pink Floyd, you name it. This is another thing. He was one of the first drummers to legitimize rock drumming in the education field. His 1972 best-selling book amongst drummers, over 300,000 copies sold. Remember, that's a drum method book. That's an insane number. Realistic Rock. He was also the first rock drummer to conduct clinics at college campuses, music stores, theaters, clinics which still managed to break attendance records for drum clinics. For a great listen to the sound and why he was such a huge influence on players that later came on the scene because they're hearing this for the first time, check out the self-titled album from the band Vanilla Fudge, and you'll get an inkling of why they were so blown away from that sound. And try to put yourself in the place of this is the first time you're hearing this. And now we're about to start running through a who's who in rock drumming. We'll start with number 14, John Bonham. If you follow this channel for any length, you know I have an affinity for him. I love John Bonham's playing, for what he did for the craft, for the influence he had on the players, for his finesse, for his power, for his insane bass drum. What is even happening there? The triplets he was known for playing at breakneck speeds, as well as the human element that comes through his playing. That's something I'm very attracted to in players, is whenever you can hear the humanity in their playing. Around 1968, Bonham joined Page in the New Yardbirds. They would later change their name to, as you know them, Led Zeppelin. Every member of Led Zeppelin said they would not have been half the band they were without John Bonham. Again, two identifiable features that I just mentioned are going to be his blazing triplets between the hands and the feet, as well as his right foot and the patterns he would play both in grooves and in drum fills. He influenced an entire generation of drummers and is widely hailed as one of the greatest drummers of all time, and I'm 100% think he deserves that. Unfortunately, like Keith Moon, Bonham died all too soon before we got to have any more great art from him. He, after a 12-hour alcohol drinking binge, he fell unconscious and died aspiration of his own vomit. He had consumed an incredible 40 units of vodka. And that's the dark side of rock and roll we don't always talk about. With these extreme personalities come sometimes extreme problems, and those extreme problems always don't get resolved. And for some reason, as Spinal Tap jokes, it's often the drummer that exits prematurely. Look, check out any of the Led Zeppelin albums to hear Bonham's fantastic drumming. A couple of note would be Led Zeppelin 4 and then Physical Graffiti. Here's another one that some of you might get angry about. That's okay, discuss it in the comments. Number 15, Mr. Phil Collins. A name most of you probably already know, and some of you are like, wait a second, Stephen, Phil Collins is a singer. Yes, he's a singer, he's a pop star, but before that, he was the drummer of a band called Genesis. He had his first band, Flaming Youth. They released one album in 1969. He then snagged the drum chair for the British art rock band Genesis in 1970, while continuing a separate jazz career. Remember, a lot of these guys coming out of the jazz idiom with a group called Brand X at the same time. Peter Gabriel abruptly left Genesis in 1974. And get this, they auditioned over 400 singers. As a guy that's been in multiple bands, I cannot imagine auditioning that many singers. And after that, they're like, maybe we should give the drummer a chance, which is a lot of opportunity for drummer jokes right there. But they gave the drummer a chance, and it's a good thing they did. He also has the distinction of playing what is arguably the most air-drummed drum fill of all time. It's when the drums come in. Some of you are like playing it right now. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do In the Air Tonight. Check that track out if you don't know it. For some classic Phil Collins playing, you can check out the Genesis album, early album, Selling England by the Pound. Hopefully that'll help you understand why he's on this list. Number 16, it's still raw for a lot of us. We recently lost him, Mr. Neil Peart. He was nicknamed the Professor by drummers around the world. Again, as I just said, we recently lost him, and he has been arguably the most popular, consistently popular drummer of recent time. That's in, whether you're looking at Modern Drummer Reader's poll or, you know, any poll they put out, he's always coming out at the top. He joined the Canadian rock band Rush in 1974 was their drummer and lyricist. He's known worldwide for his finesse, his ingenuity, originality, drum solos, incredible speed, insane accuracy, and so much more. Having been a guy that tried to film 7 Neil Peart drum lessons in a row, horrible idea, I can attest the guy was just a monster. So crazy, because a couple months ago I wouldn't be saying was just a monster, I would have been saying is a monster, but again, he was also an accomplished writer. I've read most of his books, authoring 4 books. My favorites would be Ghost Rider and then Traveling Music. Without a doubt, you need to start with the Rush album Moving Pictures. Every song on this album is just banging. A little personal story. A friend of mine used to be, this was when I was in high school, and Rush was well before my time, but a friend of mine used to be a bouncer. He was an older friend of mine, and he, you know, was talking about it. I said I was a drummer, and he said, oh, then you know Neil Peart. And I said, no, I don't know Neil. And he's like, you don't know Neil. So he came back, and he actually, this was, you know, I still had a cassette player, even though CDs had become popular, and he brings me this cassette. And he's like, here, you have to listen to this. And I remember putting it in there and thinking, first of all, this singer's voice is insane. What is happening here? And then just hearing the drumming and going, whoa, forget the voice. What is going on with that drumming? And I was hooked from that time. I just remember going to school as this punk rocker and listening to Rush because the drumming was just blowing my brain open. We're almost to the end. 4 more to go. Number 17, Steve Smith. Voted by Modern Drummer as one of the 25 top drummers of all time, he's really well known for his work with the rock band Journey. He began drumming at the age of 9, attended Berklee College of Music in Boston between 72 and 76. He was studied under Alan Dawson. You heard me talk about him on this channel before. A couple of my former teachers took from Alan Dawson as well. Mr. Gary Chaffee, many of you worked through his books. From 1978 to 1985, he was the drummer for Journey, and then he returned again in both 1995 and then recently in 2015. In addition to his drumming career with Journey, he also has had an incredible career playing fusion, jazz music, world music with his own band Vital Information and other groups. He's known in the drumming world as being someone that's always pushing the boundaries of what he can do, what the craft can do. He's also been active on the clinic side of things as well as the educational and instructional DVDs. Some of his instructional DVDs are my favorite of all time. For some of Steve's rock playing, there's tons of other playing that he's done out there. Check out the Journey album, Escape. Some of you are like, when's he gonna say it? When's he gonna say it? When's he gonna say the name? Number 18, Stewart Copeland. If you've watched this channel for any length of time, you know that I love Stewart Copeland's playing. He's one of my personal faves. I came up in punk rock. He was a member of the Police, the most popular group coming out of that post-punk era of the late 1970s, early 1980s. Another one would have been The Clash with Topper Hedden. By the way, if you have not listened to Topper's playing, you should. If you like Stewart Copeland, Topper is right there with him, putting in funk, reggae, R&B, you know, all of that stuff, ska, into this pop-infused punk. Stewart's ranked number 10 as Rolling Stone's greatest drummers of all time. He was the son of a CIA agent. He's lived such a great life. Son of a CIA agent who spent his formative years in the Middle East. He later attended college in California and then moved over and settled in London in 1975, drumming for progressive rock band Curved Air. Shortly thereafter, he founded the Police with Sting, and after their first hit, Roxanne, that just skyrocketed them to success as one of the most popular and innovative bands coming out of that post-punk punk rock era. I really dove deep into this in the members area on my website, and I actually have a history of punk rock drumming, a chorus on it, and so I got to kind of see the development of that and just how he came out of that. So it's just a really cool thing to study if you just want to just really nerd out. By masterfully weaving rock, reggae, funk, and world rhythms together, Copeland still has one of the most identifiable drum sounds out there. And then in 1983, at the top of their popularity, the Police disbanded, and Copeland has gone on, like some others, to have a very successful career as a composer, an orchestra composer, a film composer, a television composer, and a composer for video games. Two of my favorite albums. Let me see all of them. Check out Ghost in the Machine and Synchronicity. If we're just gonna give you something to like, hey, here's an appetizer, check this out. It's Stewart Copeland. If you love him, dig deep. That's gonna be what I would start with. Number 19, again, there may be some hatred. There may be some dissension in the ranks. There may be some backlash in the comments section. Dave Grohl. Most of you don't need me to tell you this player's name. Some of you will disagree with me putting him on this list. I think you are wrong. He was the longest serving drummer for the grunge outfit Nirvana from 1990 to 1994. Nirvana helped launch an entire style of rock music, a subgenre, grunge, and then also became the spearhead and the kind of poster child of really an entire youth movement, an entire generation. After the suicide death of Kurt Cobain and the disbanding of Nirvana, Dave Grohl founded the Foo Fighters. I still remember hearing about this project and going to the record store, and I'm like, what is this thing? And I picked up the album, and I was mesmerized that a drummer had done all of this. So he's the guitar player, he's the singer, he's the chief songwriter, and also now shares, although in the beginning he did all of it, he shares drumming responsibilities in the studio with Taylor Hawkins. In addition to that, what else has he done? Oh, I don't know. He drummed for the super group Them Crooked Vultures, which has Josh from Queens of the Stone Age, as well as the bass player, John Paul Jones of Led Zeppelin. Some other things. He's toured with the Queens of the Stone Age. He has multiple solo projects, Probot being one of my favorites. And then in addition to all these projects, Grohl is also a well sought after studio drummer, playing on a lot of albums that you probably didn't even know he played on. So check out the album Songs for the Deaf by Queens of the Stone Age, as well as their self-titled album from the supergroup Them Crooked Vultures, again with Josh from Queens of the Stone Age and John Paul Jones of Led Zeppelin. I'm gonna end it with a zinger, one that a lot of you are like, what? I thought you would end it with somebody that I actually knew, and many of you probably know him, but some of you might not. That's Josh Freese. He's a current drummer that's still on the scene. He's still killing it. Born to a musical family, Josh began his professional career at the age of 12, performing in a top 40 band at Disneyland. Get this, his touring and recording career started at age 15. That's insane. Almost at the same time, first with Dweezil Zappa, and then the punk rock group called The Vandals. Now, he's a permanent member of the band, if I'm getting this correctly, of his band The Vandals, which I saw on Warped Tour years back, as well as the 70s group, or 80s group, Devo. And then he's worked with, I don't want to get this wrong, but he's worked with Guns N' Roses from 1997 to 2000, A Perfect Circle from 1999 to 2012, Nine Inch Nails from 2005 to 2008, Weezer from 2009 to 2011, toured with Paramore on their South American tour in 2010, returned to playing with Sting full-time in 2016. He had toured and recorded with him before in 2005. You get an understanding of why he's on this list? He's one of those ghost guys, one of those studio players where you're like, who played that? Oh, wait, that guy? And then you kind of follow the breadcrumb trail and you're like, wait a second, I gotta check this guy out some more. He's an in-demand studio player and has appeared on over 400 records. Some of his playing, I mean, again, there's so many albums you could check out, but, and a lot of his is touring work as well. You can check out A Perfect Circle's album 13th Step, and then due to my punk rock roots, I'm also partial to his work with The Vandals. And there you have it, a brief history of rock and roll brought to you by the 20 greatest rock drummers you're wrong for not knowing. If you enjoyed this, be sure to check out my other 20 greatest jazz drummers you're wrong for not knowing. I'll link that below in the video description as well as in a pinned comment. I love hearing from you all. If this helped you, if this was informative, hit that thumbs up button, share it with somebody that you think it may also help as well. Leave me a comment, subscribe to the channel, and hit that bell for notifications because I am uploading new content every week. But no matter what you do, I'll see you here in the next video.